Welcome. Welcome to Montreal West United Church. Welcome back. It's wonderful for you to be able to join us. I thank you for joining us, and we're going to begin the way we always do with announcements. And I guess I just want to begin by saying we have a new person with us in the office. Vicky has taken over for Samantha, who's taken over from Barbara. So we've had some nice, amazing people. We've been so blessed with such talent and gifts. But Vicky's in the office now as our administrator. And if you come to the church or call the church, that's the first face or the first voice that you're going to see. And I just want to say to Vicky, you're doing an amazing job. And we feel profoundly lucky to have you. And for those of you who haven't been to the church recently or called the church, you have a wonderful person to meet waiting there to greet you and meet you as well. The church is a quiet place these days. It has been for many months. And a lot of the things that that make us a church family have had to be canceled. We haven't been able to worship together in quite some time. Our bazaar right now, I don't think it's going to be happening. And the same for the fireside supper. Those things are basically not happening. And we're just hoping nothing else has to get canceled or postponed. But one comfort that we do have, one tradition, one piece of familiarity is the West Word. And the West Word will be distributed as normal. It will be coming to your house, or if you want, you can get an online copy if you prefer that. But the West Word is a little piece of Montreal West, our newsletter, which is published in the fall and in the spring and at Advent. And so it will be coming out as usual. And my submission is just a reminder that during difficult times like these, we just have to find ways to comfort one another and to go on as a church. And so, the medium is the message. In a sense, with the West Word, we are going on as a church, and we're going to try to do everything else that we can to remain a church. And especially these services. These services are a big answer to how we are continuing to be a church. So if you know of someone who doesn't have the internet, you can always call the church. We have a tablet that's floating around, and the tablet has all of the services preloaded. Don't need the internet to watch them. Just one touch, and that's ready to go. And we will continue to persevere, even though we've taken a little step back. We're in Code Orange. Things can only get better, and we're going to continue to be a church and to find ways to connect and to be together like this right now. And so here are my announcements. I have this message from Extra Miles. Handicap V Dignité is having a memorial service. So on October 1st is International Seniors Day, and they're holding a virtual memorial for caregivers and family members and others who know seniors who died in the pandemic. They want to particularly remember those who were in long-term care homes, where 80% of the deaths in Quebec took place. This is a celebration of people's lives through pictures, music, images, flowers, art, and short testimonies. And if you're interested in seeing it, being part of it, contributing to it, honoring your loved one, please just contact the church, and we'll give you the connection details for Handicap V Dignité. So just call the church and we'll set you up. This yesterday we celebrated the life of Marge Armstrong, our dear, dear friend. And so once again, my prayers, and I'm sure all of your prayers will be with me. And throughout this service, we'll be remembering Marge, the craft group, and worship every Sunday. She just meant so much to us. And so our prayers and our love go out to her family. And my final announcement is that this is kind of a special service. We continue to be in creation time. And so our service today is all about creation, environment, ecology. And so we had a special guest today. Right before the sermon, I've invited Patricia Lisson, who used to be the executive director of St. Columba House, to offer us a few words. She received a grant from the Kelly Trust, which has its origins in this community, and so she really feels that we are her supporters and that we're behind her in her ministry. She's back from a trip to the Philippines to oversee what some Canadian companies are doing in as far as mining in the Philippines, and when the average Filipino kind of is in the way, what tends to happen. And so she just has some words about that trip, and she just feels really connected to us. So I just want to thank Patricia, and let you know that just when after we have the scripture reading, basically I've invited her to speak before I speak and offer the reflection. So we have a really full service today. Welcome to the church. We continue to be the church, and nothing will stop us. For now, I think it's time to begin our worship. Let us pray. Loving God, open our hearts that we may feel the breath and play of your Spirit. Unclench our hands that we may reach out to one another and touch and be healed. Open our lips that we may drink in the delight and wonder of life. Open our eyes that we may see Christ in friend and stranger. Breathe your Spirit into us and touch our lives with the life of Christ. Amen.
Hi everybody, Montreal West youth and children, it's Samantha and Stevie. Have you guys ever been outside and gone for a beautiful walk next to the river and you watch the river flowing and you hear the birds singing and you see all of the beautiful trees around you? Stevie and I love to go for walks. It's super healthy for both of us, and there's no better place than outside to feel all of God's beauty around us. So whenever we go through times where we're feeling alone, or you know, we're pondering or thinking about things, one thing we can do is go for a walk, and it reminds us just how much we're surrounded by God and God's love. So we're gonna sing our song that you know now. This is our third time, and it's called "I Can Feel You Near Me, God." Sit. Good girl. Ready?
Yes, I know you're with me, God, heaven is here. Reading from the book of Exodus, chapter 17, verses 1 to 7. From the wilderness of Sin, the whole congregation of the Israelites journeyed by stages, as the Lord commanded. They camped at Rephidim, but there was no water for the people to drink. The people quarreled with Moses and said, "Give us water to drink." Moses said to them, "Why do you quarrel with me? Why do you test the Lord?" But the people thirsted there for water, and the people complained against Moses and said, "Why did you bring us out of Egypt to kill us and our children and livestock with thirst?" So Moses cried out to the Lord, "What shall I do with these people? They are almost ready to stone me." The Lord said to Moses, "Go on ahead of the people and take some of the elders of Israel with you. Take in your hand the staff with which you struck the Nile and go. I will be standing there in front of you on the rock at Horeb. Strike the rock and water will come out of it so that the people may drink." Moses did so in the sight of the elders of Israel. He called the place Massah and Meribah because the Israelites quarreled and tested the Lord, saying, "Is the Lord among us or not?" May God grant us grace to draw understanding from these holy words.
So thank you, Susan, for that reading. And now I have the wonderful pleasure of introducing you to Patricia Lissen, who I spoke of earlier during the announcement time. Many of us know Patricia Lissen from her time with St. Columba House. We've been supporters of St. Columba House here in Montreal West for many years, and every year we collect school supplies for them. Patricia is retired now from St. Columba House, but she continues to do amazing ministry. This church has for many years been supporting an initiative that began in Beaconsfield, Beaconsfield Initiative, and it sends people to the Philippines as observers of human rights issues. And I know that the minister at Beaconsfield United, Sean Friday, went, and what I remember from his story when he returned was how dangerous it was. Because really, people who are doing things that we're worried about don't want us to stop them or get in their way from doing those things. They want to make money. And so sometimes human life and human rights get in the way of that. And so we do send observers, and now Patricia has gone. And as you'll be able to hear from her report, she witnessed some very concerning things. Today is the third Sunday in creation, and so we're thinking about the environment, and as you'll hear in a few moments, and as you just heard from Susan's reading, we really have a theme today of water. And so I asked Patricia I offered her that theme of water, and she chose today to just speak a few words to us, since she considers us some of her supporters, and we have been supporting her work through the Kelly Trust. And so without any more delay, I introduce to you Patricia Lissen. Please notice the beautiful flowers in her garden, which surround her through the windows. They're just gorgeous. Patricia?
Thank you, Mark, for the invitation to share a little of my ministry that I'm doing under the auspices of the Beaconsfield Initiative and the International Coalition for Human Rights in the Philippines, Canada. The central goal is to explore and document human rights violations of Indigenous peoples in the Philippines. And how do they connect to us Canadians? You may have heard of the Beaconsfield Initiative, as it is a program from our region. In fact, this congregation, through the Kelly Trust, offered financial support for two human rights missions to the Philippines. So in a way, this ministry is yours as well. The Exodus story is a complicated story of a group of people who pulled up stakes, left their homes to find new ones. Not an easy task. In fact, in this COVID time, we probably can identify with the Hebrew story's critical elements. Lack of trust in the leadership Moses, there is no food, no water. How come you brought us here? Grumbling and complaining. Why hasn't the government done this or that? Why isn't the school doing that or this? The failure to follow God's commandments or our leaders. Finally, learning how to care for each other in ways never imagined. The Beaconsfield Initiative human rights mission is one of water, hope, and living into the words of Ezekiel, which I believe sunk into the hearts of the Hebrews as they wandered in the desert. Let each of you look not to your own interest, but to the interests of others. For it is God who is at work in you. While in the Cordillera region in northern Philippines, we visited many indigenous Igorot rural communities under the threat from mining applications or directly impacted by mining activities, resulting in environmental degradation, human rights violations, militarization, and other social and economic impacts to the community. To that end, in terms of our information gathering, we met with municipal mayors and councillors, provincial government representatives, two provincial governors, representatives from women's and clergy organizations, political prisoners, the Canadian ambassador and his staff, the Attorney General of the Philippines, children, elders, family members of the disappeared, family members of victims of judicial killings, and protesters of the mining activities. Our focus became apparent when we divided our group into two visiting teams, one going to Salapatan, the other to Tubo, where we lived for several days. Through conversations with the Igorot peoples, it became clear that the Abra River is the source of life. It is sacred, holy, and embodied with the people's lives, a place of creation and goodness, where the children play, the people wash and bathe, the fish swim, a place of celebration and delight in the abundance of the earth. It is a place of life. The Abra River is also a place of death. An individual who had spoken out against the mining companies in Tubo's community was decapitated. His body was desecrated, divided, and thrown into the river. We followed the Abra River's course from its headwaters and watched a once healthy river becoming a cesspool of deadly chemicals caused by the mining industry's tailings. This river winds its way through several provinces, many communities, and eventually into the sea. Fish that once swam abundantly now float on the surface, destroyed. Skin disease due to the polluted river plagues the Igorot people and their animals. The Abra River is now an ambiguous place, a place where the balance of life needs to be restored and whose very essence is in peril with the development of mining practices. As we heard the firsthand stories of the people directly affected individually and communally, we were awakened to the veracity of gross injustice and realities we had heard about only in theory. Upon entering the communities, we were met with unabashed hospitality and openness. Instead of finding a people filled with fear, as our North American minds might have expected, we found a people filled with radiance, warmth, and welcome. The ministry of hospitality is abundant among people facing injustice from principalities and powers threatening their indigenous people's rights. in the Cordillera, especially in Tubo and Salabadan, people radiated a way to justice through their style of theological reflection that is both contemplative and active, as in the praxis model of the liberation theologies of the Latin America. A theology of the Igorots is one of redemptive hope, embodied in the spirit of a people whose voices will not be silent, and in whom the spirituality of celebration in the face of injustice is fierce and determined. Such a spirituality or value system can be described as practical, resistant, and celebratory. The theology is shaped out of the local people's practical and strength, predominantly indigenous in their heritage. The indigenous worldview teaches that the creator god, Kambunia, gave them land, the rivers, and the resources in sacred trust. The elder stated their responsibility is to preserve the land, the water, and the resources, passing these ancestral practices of caring for the land and caring for one another to the next generation. As the elders of the Cordillera shared with us, the land is not for the use of private organizations. It is not for the benefit of any one individual. It is a sacred trust, a responsibility that grows out of an understanding that we are not separated from, but intricately woven into the earth, along with all other life forms. We were welcomed into the practices of the elders and celebrated in their communities. We were invited into a covenant relationship to tell their stories, take action on injustice, and continue a bond of connection and solidarity with the people we had met. And thanks to the Kelly Trust and other ways the church has financially supported us, we have moved forward with this. The Beaconsfield Initiative has grown into the International Coalition for Human Rights in the Philippines, Canada. And we have taken and embarked on many concrete actions to address these injustices. We have been in contact with members of Parliament. We have mounted a number of educational webinars. And one concrete way you can be involved in this is to go online and sign our e-petition, which is now in front of the House of Commons, supporting regulation of Canadian mining practices, of Canadian mining companies who are operating in the Philippines. For more information, you may contact me or your minister who has my contact information. Thank you.
Thank you again, Patricia, for that amazing testimony and for your amazing work. I am indeed very proud to call you a friend. And hopefully, just before I arrived here on camera, you all saw the links to the petitions that Patricia is inviting us to consider signing. And so please consider that. I think it's important that we do. It's important that we speak up for what we believe in and for we give a voice to those without a voice. And so at this point, I'd like to offer you a reflection on Susan's reading, the scripture for today. And let me first say that last week, the people were scared and hungry. This week, they're scared and thirsty. But other than that, these two stories are almost the same. But why would God tell the same story twice? Well, one would have to think that God thought the message was that important. And as I explained last week, for me, one of the most important messages in these two texts has to do with faith and fear. Fear turns us inwards. Fear reduces our focus. It narrows our horizon. When we're scared, we tend to only think about and focus on what we're scared about. We become completely focused on our own self-preservation, and we can't see anything other than that. And I guess that's natural when we're scared. And the problem is, when we're scared, it's hard to see all that's happening all around us because we're so focused on ourselves. And so, to take an extreme example, if our neighbor were drowning, we may not even notice because we're so focused on our own lives, on our own survival. In fact, quite often we can even perceive our neighbor as an obstacle to our self-preservation. They can get in our way, they can slow us down, or be competing for the same resources we feel we need, the same places on the lifeboat, so to speak. And so when we're this scared, we can easily get cut off from our neighbor or even become hostile to them. But as we saw last week, there is a remedy: faith. It starts with faith in God, and it leads to faith in the world, in creation, which leads to faith in our neighbor, which leads to faith in our neighbor even in the desert or in a time of crisis. And we saw that when people had faith even in the desert, well, it led to an abundance of food last week, and this week it led to flowing water. But I don't need to tell you all this again because I told it to you last week. So rather than give you the same message again, I think I'll go in a slightly different direction this week. This week, let's talk more specifically about water. I remember an economics professor once asking me what I thought was the most precious resource, most valuable resource on the planet. My first thought was energy, so I said oil. He told me that it was a good guess, better than gold or diamonds at least, but he said that in his opinion, what was actually the most precious resource on the planet was water. That is, at least, he admitted, until corporations could figure out a way to sell air, in which case air would be the most precious resource on the planet. But corporations have figured out how to sell water, something that human beings need to live. Someone once told me, we can live 3 minutes without air, 3 days without water, 3 weeks without food. Imagine that. Only 3 days without water. And interestingly enough, we need exactly 3 liters per day to stay alive. However, staying alive and living as human beings are two totally different things. And just drinking enough water to live isn't much of a life. We need to produce food. We need to wash ourselves and our clothes and our homes. So the United Nations has determined that every human being on the planet needs, at the very least, 50 liters of water a day to live with a minimum of human dignity. In other words, we need 50 liters of water per day to be fully human, which of course makes the buying and selling of water very controversial. A few years ago, the chairman of a major bottled water company made a slip of the tongue, one that he truly regretted, I imagine. He was defending his company's right to profit from the sale of water, and he said, "Water is, of course, the most important raw material we have today in the world. It's a question, however, of whether we should privatize the normal water supply for the population. And there are two different opinions on the matter. The one opinion, which I think is extreme, is declaring water a public right. That means that as a human being, you should have a right to water. That is an extreme solution," he said. "The other view says that water is a foodstuff like any other, and like any other foodstuff, it should have market value," end quote. He means a price. After global outrage and boycotts of his company, he later retracted the statement and admitted that, on second thought, human beings do have an inalienable right to water. But he continued to insist that the privatization and commercialization of water would help the world to have more clean, safe water. Privatization would increase investment in water production and would increase the supply of water. And so there was an advantage, he was trying to convince us, an advantage to letting people privatize water for profit. Furthermore, he argued that if water didn't have a price, then what is there to stop people from wasting it? For instance, if water is free, what's to stop golf clubs from watering their lawn during a shortage? If a golf club wants to use water that way, then they should have to pay for it, he claimed, or he was trying to argue. So, therefore, his point, water needed to have a price. Which only leaves one question. What if some people can't afford the price? Or what if a golf course can afford to pay more for water for their lawn than some people can afford to pay for the water they need to survive? In that case, then who should have the water? The other problem is that bottled water can be 1,000 times more expensive than common tap water, which is fine if everyone has access to clean tap water and is free to choose the bottled water or not choose to buy it. But by far the biggest market for bottled water and privatized commercial water are the very poorest people on earth, because those people don't have access to common tap water all the time, and so they have to buy water and depend on companies, and that means that the poorest people on earth are paying up to 1,000 times more for their water. And I guess the irony is we have to ask ourselves, where are these private companies getting the water from? I first learned of these issues from my friend Brian, who's a lawyer working for a church, and he was invited on behalf of a group of churches to go to India to see what was happening there. It was a different company, it was a soft drink manufacturer, but the people of India were trying to ask the world for help because this soft drink manufacturer had a right to make a profit and wanted to make a profit, and what had happened was they had needed water to make their soft drink. So they'd gone to a region where thousands of people had small family farms, and they bought one farm. And from that one farm, they built a bottling plant. And on that bottling plant, they had a well. They went down 200 feet into the ground, and they began pumping water from the water basin below. And all the other farms around that bottling plant started to have less and less water for their lives and for their survival. And so the church has sent people, just like Patricia, to observe and report. And he came back horrified at what he had seen. The problem was the company was just doing what it was meant to do, make a profit, do business. But when it came to water, well, profit, business, and something that is necessary for basic human dignity, those things just get in the way of each other and they cause problems. And it's not just happening in India. That water bottling company is also in Canada bottling water and selling water to us, selling our own water to us. And it's interesting that in Ontario, they pay a very high rate for the water that they take out of the ground and then sell back to us. They pay $503.71 per million liters that they take up in their well. How much do you suppose they earn by selling 1 million liter bottles of water? And now imagine $503.71 of that money comes back to us. And they want us to know that's a really good price compared to what they normally pay. So you can imagine what they're paying in countries like India to purchase what is actually, and then sell back to the Indian people what really belongs to the Indian people in the first place. So these are the issues with water which I raise on this third Sunday in creation time. The privatization of water is a complex issue, and I've only just scratched the tip of the iceberg. And yes, that was a water pun. But now it's time for us to return to our scripture and the lesson that was so important that God repeated it twice. And let me start by saying that this scripture has two things that last week's scripture didn't. One, we learned the name of the place where all of these, both of these stories took place. And two, at the very end of the story, we're asked a question. And I think it is a question to which the stories have been leading up all along. What is the question that concludes these two readings, these two stories? The question was, is God among us or not? The people are in the desert, they're scared, and they're gripped in fear, which closes them off to everything but their own self-interest, their own survival. They're just a bunch of individuals, or at best an unruly mob, and they're so quick to turn on one another. Last week they were hoarding supplies. This week they're quarreling and challenging each other. Now the words Massa and Meribah refer to where these events took place. They decide that these stories, these two stories about hoarding and about quarreling, they're going to be called Massa and Meribah. And so these words actually mean quarreling and challenging. And so quarreling and challenging each other is where the people are in this story. And it isn't a good place. In fear, they're about to start killing each other, or at least poor Moses. And the reason they're quarreling and challenging and greedily stockpiling resources was fear of dying in the desert. And all of this leads to the question that Moses puts to them as the very last words in these two stories. Is God among us or not? And notice that when they remember that God is with them, when they have faith in their hearts rather than fear, then not only are they able to see one another as human again, instead of competition, instead of obstacles, as soon as they're able to see one another as human again, suddenly they discover an abundance of food and an abundance of water, water flowing in the desert. When God is with them, when God is within them, when they have faith, they suddenly discover there was enough for all along. They have everything they need, even in the desert. When fear and quarreling are among them, all they seem to perceive is the desert. When God is among them, then all they perceive is abundance, even in the desert. I found a prayer online. It contained the line, "We pray for the dry places." And I immediately thought, there are two ways to understand what dry places are. It can mean places that have no water, and it can mean places that don't have God. Places of fear, not faith. People need God just as much as they need water, and places where God is absent, in my opinion, are the true deserts of the world. Though they may have lots of water and even golf courses. Luckily, there's no shortage of God. All we have to do is open ourselves and have faith, and God will pour into us. And through us, God will pour into the world. And when God is truly among us, there will be no more dry places anywhere. Amen.
Springing from the drum.
Spirit grow.
As I mentioned to you in the sermon, I did find this prayer online. It's a prayer written by the Mennonites, the Mennonite Church in Ontario, and they call it their Living Water Congregational Prayer, and I just thought that I would share it with you on this special Sunday, where water is such a prevalent theme. Let us pray. Loving God, thank you for water, for its smooth cleanness as it runs from our taps, water that is safe for drinking, water that doesn't stop running. Thank you for beautiful blue lakes, for the chortling of streams, for the rushing of rivers, for the richness of water resources. Thank you for water from the skies, for water that falls on gardens and crops, fueling green growth, food for the world. Thank you for water for fun, for swimming pools filled with laughing children, and sprinklers making rainbows on the hottest days. Water is so ever-present, so powerful and life-giving, we almost forget that it is a gift from you. We come with prayers today for sick people. We need your Spirit of healing flowing into their lives. There are people here grieving the loss of loved ones. Comfort them with visions of eternal streams as you comfort the Armstrong family. Where we have given up hope, fill us now. Where we are lonely, fill us now. Where we can find no love in our hearts, fill us now. Forgive us for living parched lives, wastelands where we think only of ourselves, and spare no thoughts for those around us. Thank you for your presence, which bubbles up, refreshing and enlivening our hardest places. Today, we pray for dry places in the world, for lands where people walk long distances for water, where weather patterns have changed and people wait for rain. We pray for countries where access to water becomes a weapon of oppression. Loving God, give us a thirst for righteousness and justice. Help us to work for peace in our world, for there is so much water, and yet so many are thirsty. We pray all of this in Jesus' name, who is living water for us all. And so we continue to pray together, and now I invite you to pray with me the prayer that Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
In spite of dungeon, fire, and soul. cross of Christ still burning bright. Faith for today, O living faith, we will be true to you till death. Faith born of God, O call us yet, bind us with all who follow you, sharing the struggle of your cross until the world is made anew. Faith born of God, O living faith, we will be true to you till death.
Thank you all for being part of this service. Thank you especially to Patricia, who took the time and wanted to take the time to speak to us and share with us, because she really feels like we're part of her ministry, which should just fill us with pride. Don't forget to consider signing that petition. And for now, I'd like to thank Kevin and Roy and Samantha and Stevie and Susan and Owen and the choir and everyone who helped make this service, and especially to thank everyone who's taken the time to share it with us. It means so much to us to have people with whom to share worship, which means so much to us. But for now, I offer you this blessing. May the grace of God and the love of Jesus Christ and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit bless you now and always, until we're together again. Go in peace. Amen.